Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Observer Research Foundation. Today we are here for this book discussion by a very dear and senior colleague of mine from the civil service, Mr. Pradeep Baijal. So I'm especially honored. You know, we keep on doing book releases on and off, but to have a senior colleague come with this brilliant book on a subject which everyone has been talking about, discussing about. I think the number of books which have come out on China in the last few years, in fact, in the last 10 years, there have, you know, every year there are dozens of books coming out on China, both in India and abroad. And the point is that you love it or hate it, China does command the imagination of everyone around the world today. And what is unique about the effort that Mr. Baijal has put into this book is that, you know, he comes in from the most unlikely candidate to be actually writing on China. He has had a long innings as an administrator, was very much part of the reform process in India. He spearheaded major changes in the telecom sector when he was heading that industry and sector. And he was really looking at the reform process as it unfolded in India with all its hiccups, with all its breaks. And on the other side, you know, in the distance, there was another country roaring away, growing away at a tremendous pace, breakneck speed. So I think that is where your fascination with China really arose from. That what is it? What is it that made the difference? What were the key points which made China so different from India? Why did China gallop ahead and reach where it is? And why did India lumber on, you know, like the elephant it was, and is still lumbering on towards a certain path for development? So coming from that perspective, from his own experience of the process of reform, of change, as it took place in the country, he, lays down a very great perspective for anyone who wants to understand India-China within that context. And no matter who we are, you know, whether we consider China as an emerging superpower, or we consider it one that has already arrived, or we consider it the brat on the block wanting to take over the world and the great hegemonic superpower, we may have various perspectives on China. But the fact is, China is today where it is. And it has brilliantly used, very well used, developments of the last century. You know, primarily the latter half of the last century was devoted to building an empire of globally acceptable norms around free trade, globalization, technology, which China really rode very effectively to reach where it is today. And the real transformative effect of these came when technology built the tremendous networks which allowed the integration of global value chains. And China became the manufacturing hub of the world. You know, that is how it rode the global value chains to position itself as the most competitive manufacturer in the world today. The world shifted, and definitely China attained a competitive edge which today it is extremely loath to lose. It is not something it is going to give up easily. And that is where, you know, there is a play of strategies emerging across the world which we are facing. And the entire strategy which China has built upon and is building upon as to how to use the major geotechnological shift which occurred at the end of the last century, which it used to its advantages, how to keep on leveraging on that and make sure that it becomes the leading power in the world. So these are some of the, this is the background, I think, which Mr. Baijal has very brilliantly explored in his book. So very interestingly, 2017, as Donald Trump ascended and became the president, I remember Davos, January 2017. And who was the big hero of Davos in 2017? It turned out to be President Xi. And President Xi then gives this great speech about, we should not develop a habit of retreating to the harbor whenever we encounter a storm, for this will never get us to the other side of the ocean. Well, that is one of the quotes from his speech. We should recede from our respective national positions and embark on the right pathway towards economic globalization at the right pace. Another big quote. And suddenly he's hailed as the hero at Davos, the force for globalization at a time when the US is under retreat. So this was the president of, you know, the world's most protectionist, the most predatory economy in the world, which for years had been openly using state-controlled mercantilism as an instrument of power, suddenly being crowned as the leader of the free world in Davos. So there are ironies, lots of ironies in all of this. So these are, you know, lots of issues which have been referred to, you know, that what has led to this transformation, where does China stand now? If you need to understand where the US is coming from today, where Japan stands today, where India stands today, I think Mr. Baijal's book is an excellent primer to lead us to how we got where we got. So with these words, I will intervene later, but I think with this, I'll pass it on to Manoj, who himself is a great China hand. He has written so much repeatedly on China, and he keeps on writing. Manoj, please carry on.
Thank you, Sunjoy. I think we'll take it up from here. The main idea out here is really to discuss this book and the ideas that Mr. Baijal has put forward. So what we're going to do is that I'll request Mr. Baijal to give us short, just about 10 minutes of this book, and then I will ask him certain leading questions. So we'll do a Q&A for a short while, and then I'll open it up to everyone. And so I hope we can have a fruitful discourse. So I'll request Mr. Baijal to give us a short account of his of the book, and then we'll you and I will do a Q&A.
Thank you, Mr. Joshi. Thank you, Sanjay. I'm particularly lucky that Sanjay is here. Sanjay has been with me in Madhya Pradesh cadre, and it's always wonderful being with someone who's from your cadre. He's also helped me in editing the book. This was an impossible book. I couldn't write it. Lots of my friends in the foreign service said, don't make a fool of yourself. Don't write this book, because you don't know anything about the subject. But there are reasons which I have given in the book why I ventured into this. And my book really got made when, without knowing Shyam Saran, he gave me a review. And I have repeated that review everywhere. That review is here, that review is in this document, because that encouraged me to write the book. Because he said what I wanted to say, that in the China story, there is economics, there is history, there is geography, there is politics, there is diplomacy, there is deception. And a diplomat only, or an economist only, or a journalist only cannot write this book. This book has to be written from all points of view. And when I started writing from all points of view, I got totally confused, because the subject is highly complex. Go to chapter 6, for instance. When you go to chapter 6, you find that I have tried to discuss the financial developments in China, the financial developments in America and in the world. It was impossible. Mr. Kelkar helped me a lot. Second, I'm lucky today we have Sharad here. He was High Commissioner in Pakistan, and he will understand the subjects which I've tried to deal with, and I'll be very happy if he criticizes me. The only thing is, perhaps he'll not criticize me, because this book is dedicated to his father-in-law, and that is the first page, so he'll feel hesitant in criticizing me. Bridgman Vash is a class fellow from Roorkee. I couldn't have produced this book, because it was impossible. You go to a publisher, he will not do hundreds of changes, but since he was the publisher and he said he'll do it out of love, both for me and for the book, so therefore it has come out. I'm very grateful to Mr. Munga, who works in India but mostly works in other countries. He's sitting somewhere here. And he gave me all the material and all the thoughts for building this story. So this story is really a story which has come out of Providence. But this was a fascinating story. 3 decades, 10% growth every year is impossible, any economist will tell you. But not only did they do 10% 3 decades, they did much more than 10% in a limited period of 2005 to 2015. No one has caught this. 2005 to 2015, they did a much higher growth. In 2000 or 2000 to 2005, BRICS was set up, and Goldman Sachs, the leading investment banker in the world, did 2 stories on BRICS. And they said Brazil, Russia, India, China, same league, sort of trying to go forward, etc. That's the BRICS story. In 2005, China convinced the world, no, China is a different story, it is not a BRICS story. And if you see, and that's why I insisted that we must circulate this, and then if you see this graph, and you see 2000 here, and you see 2005 here, we are, India and China are in the same ballpark, and that's why Goldman Sachs got fooled when they wrote the report. But see, after 2005, the China's growth curve shoots up. Now, how did that happen? All the world says, all the economists says that the man was Deng. But Deng was president till 1987. Deng was finished. And he died in 1997. The growth started in 2005. And that's the miracle which no book in the world has got. And I always said that there has to be an India story in this book, because who's affected the most? India is affected the most. We are both 1.3 billion people. We are both large countries. And particularly, till about 1990, we were sometimes ahead of China. Only a couple of years back, everyone who's sitting here, everyone was born. Then that story doesn't get over there. 1990 till 1990, we were both fooling around and doing nothing. Then this story started in 2015, the world got changed. How did this happen? We were both very foolish. Chinese used to come and meet me. I used to be in the steel ministry, and they were very foolish. They were making small furnaces, which was heresy in steel. But how did this happen, that suddenly they took over the world? So that is the process I have tried to study. Then, of course, I have been in all reform departments in Government of India. I have studied in Harvard, Oxford, Tokyo, at government's expense. So I thought I must write a book. And last 3-4 years, I had nothing better to do. So I started writing the book. And it was a very tough job. It was an impossible job to write this story. But at the beginning of the story, I have given a graph borrowed from medicine. And this graph shows what has happened to the world. This graph shows that till about 1820, India and China shared the world. We were 50% of the world's GDP. 1820. As recently as that. Then, first industrial revolution's effect came, and the looting of the colonies came, and from 1820 to 1970, we became 5% of the world's GDP. We were finished, both India and China were finished. 1950, of course, both India and China got independent. After India and China got independent, China took a path, India took a path, China made a fool of itself. Red Guards, New Deal, repeated famines thereafter, they made a fool of themselves. But I don't know how, sitting in that country, Mao thought that this will not do. And Mao thought, I must collaborate with the United States. So he sent people to United States. United States said, sorry, we don't trust you. They refused to come. So Mao thought again. Then he got hold of or De Gaulle, he got hold of Yahya Khan, he got hold of many other world leaders, and told those world leaders through Lee, the Singapore Prime Minister, who was also a native Chinese, you go and convince Nixon. And he knew that Nixon was highly egoistic. He knew that Nixon couldn't think long. That's how he got into Watergate, etc. That's why he got into so many problems. And Nixon was convinced. And he convinced Nixon before elections. And Nixon wrote an article, and he thought this was his story. And he wanted to go to China. When he tried to go to China, Mao didn't welcome him. Because Mao wanted to give an impression to the world that the Americans are coming to me. I'm not going. Look at India. India also got independent in 1950. What did we do? We said the centrist form of government, Russian form of government, Russian centrist government, etc., etc. And when Russia started failing, we started copying them. Whereas China, Mao gave up Russia very fast. Of course, they were also a part of Cold War with the United States, Russia. And Nixon thought that I'll finish Russia by collaborating with China. But what happened? first, they tried to collaborate. They couldn't collaborate. Then, by the time they collaborated, and Nixon thought that now I'll gain, Russia had already collapsed. The entire Eastern Europe had collapsed. That led to all the American presidents, Nixon and seven presidents thereafter till Obama, to think that we are world beaters, no one can touch us. And they made a fool of themselves. They abetted and helped and financially helped the growth of China. For so many years, both Russia and China were progressing towards democracy. So Russia applied for WTO membership, China applied for WTO membership. Imagine, China got WTO membership in 2001. I've given a graph here of the impact of that. And Russia got membership in 2012 because the Cold War, which was actually over, was still in American minds. That look, these fellows sent the satellite to moon first, and we could not. They are brilliant guys, we must kill them. And he helped them in WTO, he helped them financially. If you read chapter 6 in the book, I have tried to give all details. I was very particular that I give all the aspects of this story. So I wrote a 500-page book. When I sent the 500-page book to Sunjoy, he said, who reads 500 pages? I also read a brilliant book by Kishore Mehboobani of Singapore. Has the West lost it? That book was 91 pages. And they said that no one reads beyond 150, so reduce this to below 150. Now it was very difficult, reducing it from 500 to 150. But thank God that I did. Actually, this is 240, but there are lots of frills, references, etc. I've been very particular to give extensive notes and references so that young girls and boys like them can know where I'm quoting from and what am I saying, because the book is 150 pages. So book, so lots of people when they sit and touch, No, sir, but what happened in 1962, why did this happen, etc. I have tried to cover the processes, and I have tried to give to the readers a consolidated book. Then I can write 10 books out of this, the amount of work that I have done, and my people have done with me together. I can write 10 books. But I said I must give a comprehensive book to Indians who are not exposed. Who's exposed to these stories? China and United States. All these stories have been written by China, United States, or their sympathizers. So every book has an angle. So I have tried to give an Indian angle. India is finished if we don't deal with this story. And why are we finished? And that will be my last point. Why are we finished? We are finished because China has realized that no country can survive unless it goes to IR4, Industrial Revolution 4. They've realized that no country can go forward, and luckily I've been in telecom, so I know this. No country can survive if you don't go to 5G. And you can't go to 5G by wishing it. For 5G, there has to be a very big policy. I don't see it coming out. So China, first 5G telephone was done in China. China has got the maximum research in IR4. And IR4 is something like AI, artificial intelligence. India will be finished if we don't recognize that we have to move to algorithms. What are we doing today? Today, we are doing software. All these companies will be finished once IR4 comes, once 5G comes, and there have to be policies to do this. But then Sanjay said that they are the biggest manufacturers in the world. Yes, they are the biggest manufacturers. So when AI comes, they will be impacted the most, because most people will lose their jobs. But yet, their investment in IR4 is mind-boggling. They've got investment in China, and they've got investments in USA. They've sent their boys and girls to USA who are committing thefts. So far, no one realized this. But Trump has realized it fully. And people said, no, Trump, foolish fellow. And it's something like, no. Manoj Modi, Narendra Modi, foolish fellow. So when you try to change from one set of assumptions and one set of system to another, people call you foolish fellow. Trump, Narendra Modi, and you have to go back to Machiavelli's book, The Prince, chapter 6, where Machiavelli says that if anyone wants to change, he's dead. So when Sanjay comes here, whatever was ORF should continue to be same ORF. He should not try for more inputs. And I had always thought that I'm writing this book to forget disinvestment and telecom, but I can't. I thought, suffered Machiavelli's impact when all kinds of inquiries were started against me for 4 years. But this sentence is, I've said it and I've withdrawn it because I don't want to get into this. So it is a change which will impact the world in a big way. People say, no, but IR4, how can IR4 survive? So many people will lose their jobs. If there are profits in IR4, people will get those profits. It will be a question of redistribution. I'll read Joseph Stiglitz again. How to redistribute. But you can't go forward without adopting all technological changes. And one more point with your permission. Lots of Western ORFs have now recognized that what China is doing is very dangerous. And what is China doing? China is creating markets for its product. It's always products, manufacturing follows markets. Markets don't follow, it is some economic theory also, which please tell those people, I think it is Bretton Woods? Yes, so, but here what they're trying to do, they're trying to create markets to suit their products. And I've given the data in this book. But how do they reach those markets? So, they've reached through BRI, and that's why BRI is going to all kinds of places. If you see, I've given the data here, one country where they've gone the maximum is Nigeria. Why have they gone to Nigeria? Because Nigeria had a lot of reserves. China has cornered all the minerals and particularly the rare earths, and you see where BRI is going. BRI is going in this direction. Why are they doing this road through Pakistan? On Indian territory. They're doing this because they want Africa and Middle East to open for them. And what are we doing? We are tolerating them in Doklam And we are not fighting in the road they are building in J&K. We should fight that road they are building in J&K, because without that road, China is finished. Trump has also adopted a number of policies. I've taken more than 10 minutes.
Sir, I need because you're still, you're the person who we're going to focus on in this conversation. See, basically, I think, as it's very clear that the book has come out at a very interesting conjuncture in developments in the world, because we are seeing this process, which is still underway, where you may have a decoupling of the US economy and the economy and China. And this is the big effort. We don't know whether it will go in this direction, because though Mr. Baijal spoke about Trump, Trump tends to take two steps forward, one step back in a very confusing way. And we don't know where, is he out for a deal? Is he out to make a deal, or is he out to to take on China across the board? The point with China, and I think Mr. Baijal has brought out, and the book brings out very well, extensive long-range planning. You have today, back in the old days, people used to talk of Shenzhen or the high-tech economic zones, etc. Today you have this gigantic area called the Pearl River Delta, which is basically Shenzhen, Hong Kong, Macau, and that region. You know, you'll be surprised to know that 1,000 Israeli startups work there, Israeli startups. So you can imagine startups from everywhere else are also there, because it has an ecosystem. And this is the challenge that we really have. We need to create ecosystems, we need to get into value chains, etc., etc. Now, I'm not, since we're here to discuss the book, that's a separate kind of a subject. All for the younger people who are listening in here, I just wanted to point out, we spoke of 5G, the technologies which are already amongst us. Because they're amongst us, sometimes we don't recognize them. I mean, if you look at 4G in our own lifetime, 4G is what enabled Uber and Ola. If there was no 4G, there's no Uber and Ola. There's no Zomato, so likewise, 5G is going to do things in your life in a more dramatic way. 5G is going to be revolutionary, not evolutionary. 4G was evolutionary, this is going to be revolutionary. So these are the issues, I think, which Mr. Baijal is focusing on, and the way we are looking at as to how does India fit into all this. To say that we have so far been missing the bus repeatedly, I think would be to state the obvious. But the point is, we have things going for us. We have the world conjuncture, and I think Mr. Baijal has pointed out. So I'm going to start my conversation. We'll have a conversation for another 10, 15 minutes, then I'll throw it open to the floor, because I know there'll be lots of responses here. So I just want to know, the first question is very basic in the sense, where did this urge, you have explained some of it, you know, to do it on a comparative framework, you know, because India is mentioned repeatedly in your book. How did you go about that?
You see, in all sectors, we made fool of ourselves. When telecom and IT went forward, 2003, a unified license was introduced and telecom went forward. And there were all kinds of stories that one has favored A, B, C. But the proof of the pudding is in eating. We had 100 telephones, mobile telephones, in 2003, and after unified license, they became 1,000. And all the losses because of the new regulation were absorbed by this 10 to 1,000, similar to what happened in China. When there was a lot of Tiananmen agitation, and everyone was upset, and everyone was shouting, democracy, this, that, the other, Deng or his successors could control everything because of the huge growth, of the huge rise in incomes, which I have explained. But despite that, when we had enormous growth in IT and telecom, they started having seminars in China. Their teams started coming here. Their big teams used to come and sit in my office. But how is it that these fools have overtaken China in IT and telecom? So I thought that, look at these fellows. They've done so well, and they have no ego. Deng always said, everything humbly, everything with a folded hand, which is not Xi. Xi is totally different, and perhaps and hopefully he'll destroy himself in that ego. So they said that we want to learn. So I thought to myself that I've been given everything by the government of India, presence in these sectors, lots of money to do courses in these areas. I must write this book. And I wanted to run away from telecom and disinvestment. So I started writing the book. When I started writing the book was different. Because when I started writing the book, Obama was with Obama, and I thought that we and other countries like Japan and Germany and Israel will be on the other side. As I started writing the book, the story kept changing, and therefore I had to write more. When I finished the book, lots of my friends, and I think Sanjay also said, no, this book is no good. This book ends in 2016, because this book has not discussed the politics of Trump, as you are saying. This book has not discussed the politics of Trump, so don't publish it. First, write a chapter on politics of Trump. I said, we'll be finished, because this is a everyday evolving story. But I have given a commitment to lots of people that I'll write the chapter, a second book on Trump's politics. And Trump's politics coincides exactly with Industrial Revolution 4. One more thing has happened in Industrial Revolution 4. IR 1, 1700 something. IR 2, 1800 something. IR 3, 1900 something. So the world was able to adjust to IR 1, IR 2, IR 3. But IR 4 came immediately thereafter. And IR 4 is therefore destroying a lot of things. For instance, because I know telecom, this G1, G2, what is it? Not G2. This 2G, huh? This 1G, 2G, 3G will all be destroyed by 5G. And just after they were installed here, I pity the telecom operators. I've done an investment and I've destroyed. So that, those were the reasons that I was forced to write this book.
So in your book you have described the US and the role of the United States. Did the US specifically facilitate China to grow at its expense? Did the US also guide China to benefit more from its trade? Because we know you described, told us about Nixon and the opening and Deng Xiaoping. And the US for a long time believed that we could socialize China. China would become like Western countries and eventually become part of the global system, which is led by the United States. But today, feelings seem to have changed. So what is your take on that?
In a number of books, in a number of papers, they said that the main aim was that you bring China to the US bloc. US always had a bloc. Earlier, Japan was part of that bloc, and US finished Japan by the Plaza Accord, by the Nixon shock, etc., which you're aware. So they thought that they were embracing China for their own advantage. They thought they were acquiring a Chinese market. But what did the Chinese do? I've described in the book. They did the famous judo trick. That they didn't give them the market. What they did was that they gave them spaces, like the space that you mentioned, and Americans went and invested there, Israelis went and invested there, and with that investment and cheap labor and dynamite and communist government, they captured the world. I've given data, 80% of world computers are manufactured in China. 28% of automobiles are manufactured in China. So they conquered the markets which the American corporates were supposed to capture because of this policy. But American corporates captured that market with factories located in China. So I think they made a fool of them. And I'm still surprised how the Americans could be made a fool of. They made a fool of Americans in WTO. That they got WTO membership, and I had a joint secretary in Commerce Ministry who used to give reports when I was in the government. He said, 20 rupee ka maal milta hai Chandni Chowk mein, 2 rupee ka wo import ho raha hai China se. Now this was, even India, a cheap cost country, could not compete with China because they had big factories, they have unlimited capital, and they gave them efficiencies through a communist government, and they were able to convince Kissinger, etc., that Chinese model can succeed if communism continues. If communism doesn't continue, and you have the Russian president Yeltsin climbing on a tank and going on the Red Square. I was there accidentally that day. Or if you have a Gorbachev who thinks that glasnost and perestroika can go together, then you need different kind of theories. So these people were convinced that we had to allow fascism in China for our own benefit. But then they did not allow that benefit to be passed over. And Deng's strength was, number one, Confucius' deception. Deng's strength was 36 stratagems. And Deng's strength was that he said, like some of our leaders, ki haath jod ke apna kaam karo, apna haath jode rahiye. And that is what they did.
Well, you know, this is the equivalent of what is in foreign policy. They say Deng Xiaoping's 24-character policy, which is to hide your abilities, bide your time, etc. And I think you've put it across very well. Of course, you've already answered the question I was going to ask you, that what were the other factors, and you have introduced the issue of the Communist Party of China. Recently, last 2 weeks in the US, there's been a lot of debate. There's 95 top Sinologists signed a letter to Trump saying that if you make China the enemy, China will become the enemy. So he said that, saying that we are also playing a negative role in the present crisis. But another group of people also signed a joint letter. And the important point which you have just made is that in all these letters, in these analyses, etc., people forget that China is a unique political system. China is ruled by the Communist Party of China. And it is ruled in such a way that even the People's Liberation Army of China is the armed wing of the Communist Party. It is not the army of the People's Republic of China. So it's a very different society. And I think, could you just then tell us something about how this politics plays out, you know, the politics of China plays out in this situation?
But the politics is everywhere the same. A couple of years back, actually at the time of Tiananmen Square, they said that Maslowian tendencies are becoming stronger, which means that when you become rich, you ask for more liberties. And Chinese are asking for more liberties. But then Deng was able to anticipate this, and he crushed it in Tiananmen Square. He totally crushed it. Tiananmen Square, and gave lectures which I have reproduced in this book. He said, we must crush it. And after it was crushed, I had got photographs which show that Deng is congratulating all the generals for an operation well done. But what I don't understand is that how did Bush, who planned Tiananmen agitation, CIA, and which is written, Tiananmen agitation. How did Bush write a letter of sympathy to Deng? By this time, again, politics, Deng had gone. And because Deng had gone, Politburo wanted to kill Deng, because now he's no longer in power, so he must kill him. So they also, like Indians, they also wanted to kill Deng. and they decided to punish or even execute him. There are writings in China. At this juncture, suddenly a letter came from Bush that we sympathize with you. But in public fora, we will not sympathize. But actually, we sympathize with you. I have not understood what led him to write that letter. What politics led him to write that letter? None of the American or Western analysts, brilliant people, have gone into this factor. Why did, because perhaps America felt that our revolution is not totally over, we'll control him at some time. But today, there are two things which at least give me a great hope. There are photographs, I wanted to buy these photographs from, what is this, Tasveerin Ya Bikti? Getty Images. Getty Images.
Yes,
there
yes.
Some brilliant photographs in Getty Images. You can see them. Now, I wanted to buy those photographs and put in the book. But they were frightfully expensive. I, as a lone author, could not afford those pictures, but I have them with me. Secondly, when I started writing the book, suddenly, US decided to declassify the Mao-Nixon discussions. And they are a wealth of material. You see those Mao-Nixon decisions where, while the discussions are going on, Nixon says that Indira Gandhi is a bitch. Now, that was the result of Nixon's loss in the Bangladesh operations. So there is, so the story plays out brilliantly, that there are small egos, petty egos of world leaders. It's not that I have a small ego and Sanjay has a small ego, we are small people. But these huge leaders have petty egos. Today, I see that Deng's son, who's an invalid, because when they punished Deng before he became president, the Red Guards almost killed Deng's son. And today he goes on a wheelchair. Now this wheelchair fellow is shouting in Beijing that you can't run China this way, you can't be so cruel. So which means Maslowian tendencies which did not encash themselves in 1989 may now be powerful. I think Xi's father used to be a big pro-democracy leader. And he was punished and he died. Recently, his 100th year was celebrated in Beijing. Third, Hong Kong gives us a lot of hope that in this city, revolutions only happen in small cities. Now, in Hong Kong, a revolution is happening. In China, a small city is going into a revolt. So Maslowian tendencies are there. And I think only they will control the fascist China.
Well, the obvious question that comes up, you know, is the question, I think that's the kind of subtext of your book. Number one is, what are the means that we can use to contain China? And number two, how do you think India can, what are the steps India needs to take to catch up with the Chinese miracle?
When I was writing the last chapter, then I threw all books. I said, no book is going to propose something, so we thought and thought and thought and discussed and discussed. So I've given 10 solutions in the final chapter. But those solutions are only for thinking, not for implementing. Because it requires a lot of study, it requires people to put in their minds, it requires a number of study groups to be set up. But I have given, the first solution I've given, we should stop that road in Kashmir. You want Doklam, have a, there are solutions like that. Then India's the pride of place, India's chair in the United Nations Security Council. Then I have given 10 points, but they are not perfect. They're off the cuff, and they require far more study. They're in chapter 10.
Well, rule-based government order, global order is being challenged by the community of common, meaning the Chinese global vision. You've spoken about the Belt and Road Initiative. I think it stands to reason in the sense what the Chinese are doing is what everyone else has done. In the sense, after all, when the Americans built the transcontinental railways, so you built the railways and then you expanded and captured the whole continent. So likewise, when the US, when the British built the railways in India, the railways were built to exploit India, meaning the connectivity was a colonial, the project was a colonial one. So you have now with this Belt and Road Initiative, but yet the for political purposes, the Chinese often put up the idea of the community of common destiny, you know, and project that they have there in their new world order, things will be very different from what it is today. What's your comment on that?
Well, I think we should break up the UN, because if this argument of community of common interests can be brought forward, we should, because what are they saying? They're saying, we are newly emerging people, we are taking illegitimate, illegal means to go forward, but we are community of new interests, we should be allowed to go forward. Someone should fight that proposed order. It cannot be. You can't have a world which is not democratic.
But the fact of the matter is that the trends that we see in the world are more and more kind of, so the trends that we see are more hardline, more protectionist, slowdown in the global economy. Today we saw in the papers that the Chinese economy has reached its lowest rate of growth. Indian exports are collapsing because of the slowdown in the global economy. So at the immediate level, do you think there are measures that we can take? Meaning, I know there are some long-term measures that you...
Let me go to China, because that is what I have studied intensively. If China continues 6.5% growth over the next 20, 30, 40 years, China alone will overtake the world. I have given figures which show that China would be 50% of world GDP, 18% population, 50% world GDP, controlled by a fascist country. Now, so that is what it will be like. So the world should realize that do we collaborate with this, or do we create a separate democratic United Nations which will fight this, or whatever. I am not an expert in diplomacy, so I have only given ideas that someone has to study this, because the graph that I have given is not my graph, it's some UK. And they only said 6.5% China for the next 20, 30 years and 2.5% the world. And I've shown the graph. China will overtake the world, 18% population will take over the world. So that is very dangerous. So brilliant people have to study this and look for solutions.
So you have, you're an IT man, and in your book itself, at several points you've said that how India was more advanced than China in the IT sector. Yet somehow we were not able to create global giants like Alibaba, Baidu, Tencent, and Huawei, of course, you know, which is really a global giant. So do you think at some point that whole IT thing kind of was not able to meet its full potential?
IT thing was not able to meet its full potential because when it started growing, people started cheating. And they killed the growth. They couldn't kill the sector, it had become very big. But they killed the growth at some point in time because everyone was interested in making money. But now, the positive thing is that everyone understands this. A student of class 10 understands this. So the resistance to this kind of movement is far stronger today. Like I said, in China, there's a huge democratic movement which has come up. So the solution, I think, will come from within. The only positive point that we have is that we have a highly educated student community, highly educated and aware. And the second hope, of course, I have in all the in all the the chief of Google, Sundar Pichai, in all the Sundar Pichai, then Nadella. Nadella used to be my neighbor here, Satya Nadella, and there are so many people, and we must have hope that the stuff is good. It has to be exploited. Now, you said about these Baidus and all these, there are lots of companies who are making those efforts, but they need a huge government support. Sovereign support is necessary. And I'm not, I'm withdrawing my last sentence, that there are companies who are trying to do this. And it's a tough job. It's a tough job.
Well, what I'm going to do now is throw it open. For about 15 minutes, you know, we'll have a discussion. And you can throw your questions at Mr. Baijal, and I hope he'll be he will respond to it. So yes, Gautam.
The question. It was a very illuminative discourse, and your explanation for the book. What didn't clearly emerge to me was, has the question been answered, do we need to contain China? I mean, while it's all right to say that, you know, containing the China onslaught, but is this a given? Would you say that we need to, or we don't need to? It wasn't clear from the discussion. And if we need to, why do we need to? Because there is an opposing trend of thought, perhaps in political circles in this country, that we should accommodate and go along and rise ourselves along the way. I'm not saying I subscribe to either of these entirely, but I'd like to know from you firstly whether we need to, and if not, why not? I mean, if we need to, why? And what's wrong with the current political thing that we can go along with them? Thank you.
Yeah, it's a very relevant question. And there are many people who subscribe that why are you helping United States? They have always not helped the developing world. So let China fix them. I don't have the answer, honestly. But I'm scared at these figures which I've given. That 18% of the world population will control 50% of the world GDP if the present trends continue. And if your WTO is totally non-democratic, there is a 2017 report of WTO done by the US government. Read that report. Everything is being broken in WTO by the Chinese. So if China has to continue, which it perhaps will, it has to be a democratic and accommodative China, and not a China which is committing the thefts every day in companies. And they were very intelligent that they located those Israeli companies in a region. So they were brilliant. Now, whether you should allow this to go forward is a question I cannot answer.
Sharon?
Well, thank you, sir. I haven't read the book yet, so I don't have the advantage of knowing all that is in it. But from your presentation, I know that it'll be a very fascinating read. I'll read it in the coming days. But I think the question, an important question which has already been raised, which is for us, it goes without saying that China is our biggest challenge. We talk a great deal about Pakistan and other problems and so on, but it's going to be our biggest challenge. But the question then remains, how do we deal with it? How do we contain China? This containment carries the notion of some kind of a countervailing alliance. And you have hinted at that by saying, you know, the democracies should get together to contain China. On the other hand, there has been this suggestion of co-opting China, work with it to make a better world order. So I think one way or the other, that issue needs to be resolved. Now, when it comes to China trying to impose its will unilaterally because of its military might, for example, in South China Sea, the choices are much more clear. Although even in that case, countries are divided. Even within ASEAN, there has been no unity on that issue. When it comes to their economic performance, when it comes to BRI, for example, you know, we say a great deal about China-Pakistan economic corridor, but let's not forget that this the part which passes through the occupied part of Kashmir has been there for a long time, as Karakoram Highway. It was built in the 60s. We can keep on, you know, talking about China's performance, but unless we ourselves catch up with China, work more in that direction, we'll reach nowhere. We can criticize the Belt Road Initiative, but unless, you know, we have an alternative, with or without us, it's moving forward. It will have its own problems. It's been criticized even within Pakistan. It will run into problems in other parts of the world, but it's moving forward. So I would come back to that question, and just 2 points. One is that, what are your thoughts? I know you have said that you have projected these issues, and you know this is a further discussion. But would you have any clear preference for one option or the other? One is, you know, containing a countervailing alliance, and the other is to try and work with China. That working with China would require that we catch up. We ourselves catch up with China. We produce those alternatives which we haven't produced so far. Don't you think that's a more important issue?
Well, ultimately, such questions are very political. And India has to give an impression that it can fight. If you want to deal with BRI in Pakistan, you have to give an impression that you can fight. And again, I'm putting a political thought. When we had the last fight, the last big fight with China, in UPA government, Rahul Gandhi went and visited the charge the affairs of Pakistan, of China at his residence. Now that can't be India. India is a country as big as China, and India preferred to do that Bhaichara game. Now Bhaichara doesn't work. You are a diplomat. Bhaichara doesn't work in international politics. Second, I have compared Tiananmen with the Kashmir Hindu exodus. Now, if the Hindus of this country are thrown out of India and no one protests, I've heard journalists saying, no, but we are such a big country, we can have one Muslim state. Now, if that is our attitude, then we can reach nowhere. Suppose Tiananmen was dealt with like Kashmir was dealt with, Hindu exodus. And Kashmir Hindu exodus was dealt with like Tiananmen was dealt with. You remember what happened when Kashmir happened, and when Tiananmen happened, some of the people in China said, we are sorry, we didn't have rubber bullets. If we had rubber bullets, we wouldn't have sent those tanks. And we would have hit some rubber bullets. We had rubber bullets. And we shot rubber bullets, and people said, rubber bullets? Look at these Indians. They're fascists. So we have to be sure what our politics is. And there's already some evidence that the politics of India is helping the country. Whether the politics of a Doklam and then Rahul Gandhi visiting the charge affairs is the politics, I'm sure the thing would be different. So politics has to sort all this out. You and I can't sort it out. Politics has to sort it out.
I also look forward to reading the book, sir. But for the timing, I wanted to ask one particular question.
Courtesy Mr. Vaish, I've got far too many copies printed. Please encourage your friends to buy them.
Sure. Which is related more to regulation. What you've seen in China in the recent few years is there have been a spate of different laws, whether it was the China national security law, cyber security law, and many other legislation for that matter. At least they had, an exercise of public consultation. To what extent they have studied or incorporated inputs, we don't know, but at least there was a facade of doing that. But beyond that, what we are seeing in the recent few months is the spate of subordinate legislations and regulations, which is very, very detailed. And every time it is coming for public consultation, of course, with very short time to comment, etc. So I just want to understand from you in terms of the regulatory exercises within China, not just in the ICT sector, but broadly, how have those evolved over the years and what's been the impact of those within China?
You see, all those have to be facades in a government like China, because China basically is a fascist government. It's a communist government. So everyone in the ruling elite has to look at public outcry as the public outcry as irresponsible behavior. And that is what is happening. So again, I cannot answer that question. Politics should be able to answer that question. But I always compare Tiananmen with the Kashmir exodus. That here, we have allowed a fringe group in Pakistan to determine India's politics. What is the result of Kashmir exodus? A fringe group of Pakistan determines India's politics. So these are the answers, and consultations cannot be fair in a fascist government.
Last question. Okay, I'll take two questions, and then you and then...
Sir, I have got two questions. I've been following the politics for the last 25 years, and always I give a hope, I hear hope that we will be having the solution of the border. So, I have a personal feeling that in my lifetime, or maybe another 15 years, I'll not see a Chinese solution to the Indian border. So what is your view for that? Number two is that China has a sizable population of Muslims, which is bordering the Middle East portion of that area. What is the main reason why China is suppressing the Muslims over here? And no Muslim countries in the world except Turkey has taken any view on that.
You also ask, and then I'll take it together, and then
shadow banking and, you know, lot of investment of US, I mean, Chinese assets are in US treasuries, you know, which are giving very low returns. So don't you feel that, you know, once China goes through certain kind of slowdown, you know, this stimulus, continuous stimulus will not go for on ever, you know, because you have claimed that China will get over 50% of GDP. And my second point is that regarding the supply chains, which are very complex, you know, you are going to see a lot of, you know, emerging markets like Vietnam, Indonesia, Mexico's of the world, you know, going to come up, you know. So exclusively located in manufacturing, as far as China is concerned, is not going to be there for the in the long run, you know. So don't you feel that these emerging markets are also going to be there if, in the future? So I mean, this forecasting is going to be certainly to certain level distorted, you know. Yes.
Let me take the last question first. You see, you're 100% right, but when I wrote this book, I wrote this book from the Indian point of view. Now we can say, no, China will be sorted out by Vietnam. They were sorted out by Vietnam, you would recall, that after the US-China war, after the US-Vietnam war, there was a Vietnam-China war. And Vietnam sorted out China. Now we hope that some great guy will come and he'll sort out China. Now at least you can't plan on that basis. You have to look at the Indian problem. The Indian problem is a 1.3 billion population or whatever, and losing jobs. The only place you can create jobs in India is fortunately in IR4, provided you organize yourself for IR4. The present government is trying to organize itself for IR4. Can they do it is a question. Your question was?
Yeah.
So I talked, will there be an Indo-China border solution, number one?
You see, these questions, no one can answer. Even if I answer you, it will be a bogus answer. How can I predict? I can only ask Sharathi as a diplomatic service tappa. Bataiye bhai kab sort out hoga. He must be in one of the groups which was sorting this out.
Regarding
Muslims in China, sir.
Yes, Muslims in China, you know, I am reminded of Clash of Civilizations. Hutchinson's book. I hope there'll be a clash of civilizations in China, this question only, because these Muslims are never going to keep quiet all the time. Today they're quiet, because no one is supporting those guys.
And actually, in all these forms in Uyghur,
I think we've come to the end of our thing, because we've discussed a huge range of issues out here, and I think there's a capacity of digestion, intellectual digestion, maybe strain beyond a point. But here, I would certainly like to thank Mr. Baijal for having participated in this and given us, responded to the questions that I put up and you put up. And of course, at the end of the day, we all need to read the book itself, because that's where the substantive arguments have been made by him. But in closing this, I would like everyone to give a round of applause to Mr. Baijal.